Is it any better? Okay, how's this? Ah, that's way better. Thank you three so much. That was really beautiful. We're going to have some time for these three to be in conversation with each other about some of what they were just sharing. Then we're going to go into small groups for you all to kind of start to digest this panel, and then we'll have a Q&A. And one thing I just want to mention is that we were going to have this live streamed, and actually through conversation amongst the three of us, or the four of us beforehand, we actually decided not to live stream this panel. And so we're asking for folks to not record. We do have a video, a videographer here recording. And that was because each of these struggles has been under a lot of state repression and a lot of we have a former political prisoner on our panel. And so it's really important to recognize that in order for folks to really feel like they can have a free conversation, that we're not actually recording this in a way that's gonna go out that they can't consent to beforehand. So thank you so much for not recording. And I actually just wanted to ask for the three of you, in the conversations that we were having before this panel, I was really moved by each of you talking about how you've been connected to and inspired by each other's struggles. So I was just wondering if you would share a little bit with the room about that.
You know, I do believe in the sacred circle. And it's a gift, you know what I mean, to be part, of a panel in a place that holds so much memory for me. And before I left the island, I came across some writings that I did, and I ended one back in 2029, and I just said, I want to share this. And I said it back on the island, okay, and lo and behold, it's so true, you know what I mean? So I want to acknowledge, something that I wanted to do there, and I want to do it here. And I want to do it in the presence of these two women, you know what I mean, that embody struggle. And I want to do it in the presence, and I would hold each one of you, because there are struggles, you know what I mean, that are not being brought to this table, but with these words, may they speak for itself. And it is when our ancestors meant to put the life of the nation in order, they did not know where to start. Then they realized that in order to do that, they had to first of all put family life in order. Then they found that to be able to do that, they had to improve personal life. But those who wished to do so had to begin by putting their hearts in order. To that effect, they began to work on being sincere, and this increased their will. Once they were sincere, they saw that they needed to increase their knowledge and worked on developing their capabilities through studying, which includes man's inner life as well as the external aspect of science. Soon they understood the process and learned that studying leads to increased knowledge and wisdom. The will becomes more sincere, the heart is in order, and this way, one can begin to improve one's personal life, later on to put one's family life in order, and finally, to put the nation's life in order. Unfortunately, I never was able to find the author of these powerful words. So it is mission accomplished.
So the question is about how?
Just how have you felt connected to or inspired by each other's struggles, or how do you see some of the work that you're doing is connected.
My understanding of Palestine or the work anti-Zionism is truly an internationalist understanding. I think it's always important to remember that colonial projects have a beginning and an end, and there's hope there. And so when I fight for the liberation of Palestine, I do so with a firm commitment but belief that settler colonialism and the settler colonial state of Israel will not exist one day. And I do that, and I am able to ground myself in that hope because of history and what we've learned from other struggles, just like we learned in Algeria or we learned in South Africa, and even the struggles, but for better or worse, here in the United States and the progress that has been made in different ways. So in order to ground yourself in the hope and commitment to ending colonialism, both in Palestine and everywhere, you also understand yourself as part of something much larger. And so I was taught and mentored by comrades who fought, Palestinian comrades who fought alongside black and brown brothers and sisters here in the United States, who fought against apartheid South Africa here in the United States, who fought for the liberation struggles in Central America, who continue to fight for all of those struggles. That's how I began to understand Palestine. Those are the people who taught me. And so as soon as I engaged in political work, that's how I understood it. You know, it's about third world liberation. I began to study the history of our struggles in the 60s and 70s and how we went and traveled across the world to train and learn from people in Cuba and other parts of the world, where others also came to train with us in Algeria and in Yemen. And so the really internationalist understanding of third world liberation and how really we are interdependent and we need one another in order to win. So that's how I understand everything that I do. I don't believe we can struggle against racism in this country without struggling against Zionism. I don't believe we can struggle against Zionism without being in solidarity with all indigenous people. I don't believe any of us can be liberated without the liberation of black people. That is, you know, in of itself how the worldview that I encompass but has been taught to me by my mentors, and I hope will continue to be taught to younger people who in this society oftentimes are taught to be isolated and compartmentalized and also very superficial in understanding solidarity as just an act of words and social media posts, but not an actual political project. Solidarity is practice, it's work, it's, you know, these two women teach us that, what true solidarity can look like, what internationalism could look like. People like Donna teach us that. And we have to remember that and really ground ourselves in that history, but also that collective understanding of what's possible for the future, and working day in and day out to make sure we denormalize racism, denormalize Zionism, denormalize all forms of oppression and fight for something very different.
This manifestation of neoliberalism that's global, you know, and it's pushing us in to be exiled sometimes from our own homeland. And you know, when I came back to the States now, and got off the plane and started looking at the people around me, they weren't Puerto Ricans. I wasn't hearing Spanish language. I was hearing, you know, I mean, multiple languages, and I was seeing, you know, facial, you know, from different parts of the world. I think, you know, it's a unique experience. I don't underestimate it. Even in this room, the richness of cultures, you know. And once again, this panel is speaking on behalf of colonialism from the Native American, the Puerto Rican, and the Palestinian. But it is in all of you also, you know? And I think, what does that mean? That means that we come together on this sacred land. On this sacred land, you know what I mean? And if we can hear each other, you know what I mean? And support each other. And once again, from the soul, from the heart, I think it has the ability, you know what I mean, to be more human And for me, when I talk about the anti-colonial movement, you know, it is a liberation, but it's more a liberation at the human level. I was in, you know, the state of Illinois for 16 and a half years. So it was living with the inner city women, you know, the most marginalized of them all, that were never given a chance, you know what I mean, because there was so much poverty. And to be in that environment and to understand the importance of not being judgmental, you know what I mean, that it wasn't so much an issue of listening, you know, to behavior that was aggressive, but to understand what began to happen at the home front, you know what I mean, that created, you know, pain and created suffering, and it as a result created, you know, the consequences of finding themselves, you know, these women behind prison bars, you know. So it was a lesson, you know what I mean, of how important it is, you know, to make that connection within our communities. Within the communities. So it once again goes back to the human stories. I mean, the thing of understanding that we will be moved, you know what I mean, under this capitalist culture where happiness comes from consuming, you know what I mean, at the expense, you know what I mean, sometimes of impoverishment, the running up of the you know, credit cards and whatnot, and feeding into how, you know what I mean, who profits from that are the Wall Street bankers, and how you begin to reevaluate how you want to live this life on the outside. So it's a challenging time. It's a very, I would say, you know, thinking outside of the box and developing, you know what I mean, a vision, but a vision of life, you know, that a vision of life.
Let's go into small groups. So,
oh no, let's bring up Rochelle. Hey everybody, thank you for being here. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Rochelle and I'm on the leadership team helping out with this year's Braden program. I just wanted to start with huge appreciation for these three powerhouses for the integrity, leadership, and wisdom they bring to this powerful multiracial movement for collective liberation that we're all working on building together. I want to hear from you all. How many, raise your hand if you heard something incredibly inspiring today? How about something that's changed your framework, your thinking moving forward? And how many of you are going to take this little program that you picked up on the way in and email the Berkeley City Council and demand that we protect the West Berkeley Shona? And on top of that small action that we can all do, imagine if Monday morning they come in to 150 emails and they're in. It could make a real difference. But on top of that, we are going to resource these women and their work right now. And so, Laura, Karina, and Alicia have chosen an effort that the money that we're going to pass two baskets around, which I don't know exactly where those are. Ellen, do you know? Oh, yes, they're on it. Thank you. We're going to pass these baskets around, and they're going to fund, we're going to share the funds equally to the three projects they selected, a domestic violence center in Puerto Rico, the campaign to protect the West Berkeley Shell Mound, and the Arab youth organizing that happens under AROC's umbrella in the Bay Area. So given there's, I think, easily over 150 people here, if everyone someone can give $10 right now, we can raise $1,500 in this moment. And I know some folks can't give that much money, so if others who can give more, that'll help us reach that goal. So let's pass that around. And if you want to write a check, you can write it to Indian People Organizing for Change.
You can write it to CIEA, California Indian Environmental Alliance.
So write your checks and then we'll figure out how to square up the funds equally. If you don't have cash or a check and you want to use a card, you can do that where you checked in too. They have squares that folks can run cards on. So showing up today shows your commitment. Let's go ahead and take this next step and help resource the amazing work of these women. Thanks.
Thank you, Rochelle.
Beautiful. And now we're going to go into small groups. So find two or three folks around you and talk about what struck you from this panel and what is one question, and I repeat, one question, that you would like to hear more on. Thank you.